The economic crisis has hit. People know that we're not going to come flying out of this, that we we have had structural changes, and they're also fed up with our foreign policy, and they want our troops to come home.
It's all corporate greed.
Well, the past 10 years, with all the activity overseas, it has added $4 trillion to our debt. This means that $4 trillion would have been spent here at home. It would have been our money. We wouldn't have had borrowed, we wouldn't have had the credit, we wouldn't have had the inflation, we wouldn't have as much complication with the business cycle. But it is driving us into deep debt. And all great nations who overextend themselves overseas and develop empires, they are always condemned because they are become arrogant and they stretch themselves thinly around the world. And today, unfortunately, our declaration of war is this declaration of war, of the global war on terror. It has been announced that is every place, any time, in any country, that we have assumed that we have the moral authority to drop missiles and bombs and drones in any country. And believe me, they don't like it. And the other people resent it. They would like it much better if we promoted our goodness by setting a good example here at home.
Yes! I wish I could clap. I wish I could clap.
One thing about the military, we don't have to worry about any other country ever invading us and attacking us. We are by far the strongest ever in the history of world. We have more weapons than everybody else put together, and we have an efficient army if they have to fight. But our problem isn't a foreign invasion. Our problem is the other half of our oath of office when we swear to defend against all enemies, foreign and domestic.
Yes.
After the disastrous war in Vietnam, during the period of time I was in the military, solemn victory for us after losing 60,000 Americans, over a million Vietnamese died, and how many wounded we have, and all the money we spent, which ushered in a whole decade of economic crisis in the 70s. But shortly after the war ended, a colonel for us, an American colonel by the name of Harry Summers, met with a colonel, too, who was Vietnamese. And they got together, and they were talking, and they were cleaning up the mess, and these are the rules, and the girl leave, and this sort of thing. And our colonel said to the Vietnamese colonel, and said, "You know, you never defeated us once on the battlefield. We always won militarily." And you know,
it was a desk war.
"You are right, but it's irrelevant. Because he didn't understand, we didn't understand then, and we don't understand now. We can have a military power, and we can bomb and kill and occupy and pretend we're democratizing these countries, but what is much more important is winning the hearts and the minds of the people. And you can't do that. You can't destroy the ability of people to want to take care of their homeland. The whole idea of the Taliban is not to be anti-American. They're anti-occupiers. We worked with the Taliban when the Soviets were occupying Afghanistan.
That's right.
We're on the receiving end of it.
That's right. How about the opium that's being brought into this country?
We have struggles with power. We have politicians, a few of them running for president. And the goal is, in both of the major parties, is to obtain power, is to seek power and control and serve the special interests. It's not so much as the difference between their two philosophies. They have their special interests. The Federal Reserve protects both sides, and yet there is a struggle for power. That is real. That is a real program going on, and that is what they pretend they're different. But today it's different. It's only about power because there's no wealth there. This is the reason why there's no budget resolutions even come to the floor anymore, because there's no money left, and they don't know what to do, and they won't admit it. But I'll tell you what, they're struggling over power, and that's what politics has been about for so long. And guess what? Being involved in the campaign for liberty in which we are doing, we are winning the hearts and minds of the American people.
Yes! Yes!
There is no doubt in my mind there are revolutionary changes going on, and they're intellectual ideas that are changing. They're not brand new, but they're improved over the ideas that brought our country about. The founders were very understanding of the cause of liberty. They understood that liberty was of one unit, personal liberty and economic liberty. And this was tried and tested. We had the greatest nation, the freest nation, and the most prosperous nation. But it's on trial right now because we are no longer the richest nation. We have now claimed that we are the most indebted nation in the history of the world. Aren't producing our real productive jobs have gone overseas. So this will not continue. This is the reason that in the near future, exactly the dates I don't know, but in the next several years, what this generation will have to do, those who are getting out of school now, and I think they must understand this, because the greatest support we are getting for the cause of liberty are from the people who are from the age of 18 to 30, and I am excited about that, because that really should give us all a lot of encouragement.
Yes!
Belgian Revolution, it was only a small number of people who really carried the day. It was a small, irate, tireless minority that motivated others to join. Most people, a large number of people in the country never will come to a speech like this. But the masses of people will be motivated by others, and it is so important that we continue this because the irate, tireless minority is with us today and it's growing by leaps and bounds, and that should encourage all of us.
Yes!
As Samuel Adams described it, he says that tireless minority should be and will, for success, start wildfire, brush fires of freedom in the minds of men. And believe me, there are a lot of brush fires going on. It's going on a daily basis. People are waking up. I see positive signs. When you see statistics that show that 75% of the American people now know there's something wrong with the Federal Reserve and we ought to do something about it.
Yeah. And the Fed!
Some polling it shows that over 70% of the American people agree with us now. It's time to come home. Time to come home.
Yes. Yes! No more wars. Peace.
And that to me doesn't mean just where the active military fighting is going on, but every place where we are today, because there is a resentment we can't afford it. The troops went into Korea when I was in high school. They're still there. They've been in Germany and they've been in Japan since World War II. So it is really time to come home out of necessity. So I am very pleased that the country is coming in this direction, even though you might not hear it on TV at night, and although you don't hear it from the other candidates, I am very optimistic that these attitudes will change. For instance, the American people got pretty annoyed and pretty upset about this attack on the internet with Stop Online
SOPA.
Piracy Act, you know, SOPA.
Ooh.
And of course, with your help, we were able to defeat that. It's been removed from the floor, both in the House and the Senate. But guess what? I have another bill
it's back.
This week, which is worse, and that's called CISPA.
Ooh.
Generation, but also the internet is our friend, and they would like to control the internet. So if you care about it, let your congressmen know, let your senators know they can better not vote for this bill next week.
Yes!
Our attack on our civil liberties has been rather systematic over many decades, but especially worse in the last 10 years. After 9/11, there was a lot of concern, and much of it justifiable on what had happened. It was a terrible day for us. But instead of trying to understand the principle that the CIA has analyzed and written about called blowback, they decided to blame the American citizens and passed the Patriot Act and penalize the American citizens as if that was. So we'll put that high on the list for repeal.
How about the NDAA?
Of course, not on our list also are the all the illegal legislation passed by executive order.
Yeah!
The executive order passed just a couple of weeks ago said that the Defense Production Act would be renewed. And in the Defense Production Act, which was passed 50 years ago, gives the president authority in the times of the war to nationalize everything. Very, very dangerous piece of legislation to be on the books. But the president renewed that by taking the border, not a legislative aspect. He changed the wording. Not under wartime conditions, but even under peacetime conditions, he can make this declaration. Now, we've all heard, you know, the big complaint about the president trying to interfere and lecturing the Supreme Court over Obamacare. And he does, the Because lecturing is one thing, but what about the interference, him assuming that he can, on his own, announce an executive order that he's allowed to become the prosecutor and the judge and the jury and the executioner and execute and assassinate American citizens?
Sounds like a dictator.
So that certainly should be high on the agenda for changes. And all the laws that have been passed by executive order are up for grabs, because although I personally disagree with the idea that you should legislate anything by an executive order, I would say that a constitutional president has the authority to use the executive order to cancel out all the officers to strip search without probable cause. Anybody. And everybody should know what's going on at the airports.
The TSA.
I would think that if we tolerate this and look at what the pictures that happened of all the groping and things go on and knowing what kind of powers, you know, if we don't do something about it, we have to start blaming ourselves. We've been too lackadaisical, so we need to wake up and do something. These very special people that want special attention are those ones who are protected by Secret Service.
I keep 347.
Thinking, you know, I didn't use the Secret Service, but I didn't know quite what kind of people they were anyway. That's beside the point. But the law, what the law says was, if you're one of those special people and you're protected by the Secret Service, then you have special rights. If anybody gets within a certain distance of that individual and demonstrates by holding up a sign and politicking, you can end up getting 10 years for that.
What happened? The First Amendment, freedom of speech.
I think the arrogance and the elitism of the politicians ought to be challenged by us, and the only way we can do that is change the electorate and change the Congress and change the presidency.
Yeah!
Debt we have and how inefficient we are and all this money is being But the final conclusion was that if we pursue that, it will self-destruct. And this is what we're on the verge of, on having a much more major crisis. And it would come, and from my estimation, it would come in the form of the bursting of the last bubble. Now, we've had the bursting of many bubbles. We've had a NASDAQ bubble and a housing bubble, and they're having a little trouble getting another bubble going, but they do have one going. And the world is participating in it, and it's an illusion that we are still powerful and we still have the currency of the world, and it's not true, but there's an illusion out there. So what we have now is a bond bubble. The price of buying a bond and getting no interest is way, way too high, and the value of our currency is in the form of a bubble. It's an illusion, and the world is still taking our money, less so every single day, and other countries are now banding together, and they're challenging the us dollar. As the issuer of the reserve currency of the world. Quite frankly, I believe there's been a lot behind us going into the Middle East. When any time a country threatens to use something other than dollars or oil, the connection of the dollar and oil has been very, very important for us economically. And if that is challenged, there's a new currency, or somebody decides to use the gold currency, that means the dollar is going down, interest rates going up, and we're going to have a lot bigger problem. This is why we have to understand the economics of what's going on, understand the value of individual liberty, and how that's connected to a sensible foreign policy. And this all comes together when you understand what personal liberty is all about.
Yes!